See, if you just try to have the word only and you don't want the Holy Spirit involved, then you're going to end up with some dead legalistic doctrine. You're going to get stuck on the scripture and become actually an enemy probably to what God's trying to do. You're going to become that old wineskin and so forth. Doesn't mean that you don't have some truth, but that truth has to be able to be to move on into fullness. Amen?
Amen.
And so I want this church, you know, this church to be a word and spirit truth, or spirit church. I want it to be a church that's based on the foundation of the Word of God. And we are to judge everything anybody says, me or anybody else, on the Word, by the Word. Amen? So if you just word only, you're going to end up being like a Pharisee, probably. But if you are spirit only, well, I don't want to hear the word taught. I just want the fireworks of the Holy Ghost. Sure. I want the healing anointing. I want the tongues interpretation. I want somebody to prophesy over me. I just want the manifestation of the Spirit.
Right.
And there's an emphasis on that right now. God is moving strong in His Spirit and His healing movement.
Right.
But if you notice, people, many times, they'll show up for those kind of meetings, but they don't come to church every week to hear their pastor teach the word to them.
Come on.
And I guarantee you, those kind of people, the enemy will have his way with them eventually. Because the anointing does break the yoke. You can have an impartation that will set you free. But the only thing that's going to keep you free is the Word of God.
Amen.
You know, after Jesus was baptized, Lord, you're going to ruin my sermon again this morning. After Jesus was baptized in the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God came down and rested upon him. He had studied the Word as a young man. I mean, he was up talking at 12. He was up talking to the PhDs, asking them questions.
Exactly.
See, you're in the Bible. Did you know that? Jesus found himself in the Bible.
Right.
Who you are, not your name necessarily, or who you are, your scenario, and what time in history, but who you are to be spiritually is in this book.
Yes.
The Bible says that as we look into the face of Jesus, how do we look into Jesus' face? He's up at the right hand of the Father. You look through the mirror, you look at the mirror of the Word that reflects Him back to you. Because who you are is who He is, and who He is who you are. You'll see who you are in Him as you read the book.
Yeah.
The Holy Ghost will show you who you really are. And it says over in James that if we read the Word and we see who we are, and we walk away and we don't live that way, then we become like a person who looks at a natural mirror, studies your features, and you walk away and you end up living forgetting who you are.
Yeah.
Yes.
Amen? But having the word only will cause you to be just a... You'll end up being legalistic eventually.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen? But having the spirit only will cause you to be fanatical.
Right.
And I'm a little, not alarmed, but I'm concerned, because I see people doing what they did back during the charismatic move. Now, in the charismatic move, the gifts of the Spirit were being restored to the church, prophecy was being restored. A lot of things are being restored. People are moving in spiritual things. But at the same time, here's this parallel teaching revival going on. So it's Word and Spirit. God's moving them together.
Right.
Amen. Yeah. But you have the group just like you have today. Oh, Prophet so-and-so is going to be there? I'm going. I might get to work.
Right.
Come on. Oh, it's Pastor John again. He's a little boring.
Come on,
set
it straight.
Amen to that.
You thought I forgot about Jesus, didn't you? Go back again.
Amen.
After he got filled with the Holy Ghost,
right,
and after he was prepared by the Word and by the Spirit, he went into the wilderness to step into his ministry. And when the devil came to him and attacked him, he didn't say, "Devil, I was baptized in the Holy Ghost."
Amen.
Did he?
No.
What did he say?
It is written.
What did he say? It is
written.
Come on.
He used the Word of God to defeat the devil.
Yes.
And see, I've been in services. I've had the power of God knock me across the room. When I was at Benny Hinn's at one time, he looked at me and he went like this. I was about from me and Clarence and him. He went like this, and God knocked me about 10 feet across the stage. Felt like I got hit by a truck. I mean, it was like, whoa! And the power of God was on me so strong I couldn't get up. My arms and legs went numb. Finally, these guys were telling me to get up, and I said, I can't move. So they pulled me up and threw me over Karen's back. I'm over Karen. That's it. She's just kind of, you know, walking and bearing the burden. But for 3 hours, I felt the glory in my body. You know, I've had experiences. You've had experiences. But let me tell you something. That's not going to keep you. That might set you free. That might impart something to you that's good. That might heal your body. But the devil's going to come back. Doesn't the Bible say that when he's run off, he comes back?
Yes.
And he looks for an opening?
Yes.
So he can make it worse than it was before?
Yep.
And what's going to stop him, what your weapon is, the Word of God in your mouth.
Yes.
It says over in Hebrews, the Word of God is a sharp, two-edged sword. And of course, Karen brought that revelation down here a while back about that word. That word two-edged means two-mouth.
Yeah.
It literally in the Greek means two-mouth. I was going to have you turn here to Gideon. I don't know if we'll ever get there. But in Judges chapter 6 here, God raised up Gideon. And when Gideon went out against the enemy, he had Gideon say this: the sword of the Lord and of Gideon.
Glory.
In other words, it took not only the sword of the Lord, the Word of God, but it took Gideon releasing that through the calling and anointing on his life.
Yes.
And so many times, we don't become students of the Word. We don't let God take us into what I call the school of the Holy Ghost. Because the Bible says that the Holy Ghost, in 1 John it says, the Holy Ghost will teach us all things. That we have an unction from the Father that teaches us. And as you become a student of the Word, as you give yourself to the Word, see, the Bible says that we're to rightly divide the Word. Well, if it's to be rightly divided, that must mean you could wrongly divide it. You and I have believed, and maybe even today, believe certain things about certain scriptures that are wrong.
Yeah, sure.
I think you are telling me I'm wrong, Bruce. I remember I had these ideas in my mind about music and praise and worship and this and that. And I was up here, I got saved around 12 years old. I was up here pastoring already for a number of years before I had it dawn on me what praise and worship was really about.
Yeah.
All that time, I had my concept of what it was about, but I was totally clueless and didn't know it.
Amen.
See, God is wanting to bring us into a place of victory.
Amen.
We're real good. See, we've had a society since the 70s that's taught us to blame all of our problems on somebody else. We have narcissistic young people today because we have taught them to be narcissistic. It's all about you. You are the center of the universe. Everybody should accommodate you. If anybody corrects you, and it's real easy to slip into that. My life didn't change. I was narcissistic, proud, doing my own thing, blaming all my marital problems on Karen. It was all her fault. And a bunch of other nonsense. Until I finally, at one point in time, got honest with myself about myself. You don't ever let God tell you the truth, you're going to live in a lie the rest of your life. Now, he's not going to beat you up. God's not a child abuser. But he will give you a spanking. He will apply the Board of Education to the seat of learning. Amen. He will give you a spanking. He will correct you. And it's for your own good. It says over in, where is it, over there in Hebrews. No, that's not Hebrews, is it? I don't know. It's over there somewhere. Might as well be honest if you don't know where it's at, right? It says that his chastening, and the word chastening there means child training.
Yes.
It's in Hebrews. We got some Bible scholars in the audience. His chastening is for our own good.
Amen.
You know, over the years I've had people come to the church and, oh, Pastor, you're my pastor, and I love this church, and I'm so glad the Lord led me here. Pastor, I just want you to know, if there's anything in my life that needs to be corrected, I want you to come and talk to me. I've learned over the years, I hate to even hear that.
Right.
Because if you actually do that, they probably won't ever be back to the church out here. The Holy Ghost is already witnessing them that they need some things corrected.
Yeah.
But if you try to correct somebody about something, they think you're mad at them or you're putting them down or who are you? I saw somebody this last week had a, on the back of their car and letters about this big and a decal. My only judge is God. I thought to myself, no, you're wrong there. The Bible says judge yourself so you don't have to be judged. Most of the people that use that thing about don't judge me, is what they're really saying is, I want to live the way I want to live. I don't want to be convicted about it. And so, get out of my box.
Yes.
Yep.
Now, we're not to judge the motives of people's hearts because we don't know them. But if somebody is living in adultery and they continue to live in adultery, I can judge the fruit of that tree and tell you, honey, you better start growing a different fruit on your tree.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Because what you're growing is not going to produce good for you.
That's right.
Amen? Amen. By the way, adultery is still a sin. Just talk about it. Lying is still a sin.
Amen.
Worst sin of all is just saying no to God.
Amen.
Yeah. He can help you through all that other stuff and get it out of your life.
Sure.
If you just keep saying yes to Him. What I mean, yes, Lord.
Yes, sir.
I'm yours. Say whatever you just want to say. Do whatever you want to do. Help me, I'm here, I come before you.
Yes.
And if you say I'm wrong, I'll agree with it, even if I don't understand it.
Yes.
But then he'll teach you, so
work it out.
He'll bring you into a place so you can walk in the blessing.
Thank you,
Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
A lot of people never get anywhere because they refuse to humble themselves before the Lord.
Jesus, I wanted to preach that this morning.
I'll call you later.
Okay, yeah, call me later. Well, I prayed the sinner's prayer. I'm saved. That's probably true. If you truly pray from a heart of conviction. See, you don't get Jesus' life unless you give Him yours.
Right.
It's an exchange.
Right.
Unless you, I remember that day, man, it's imprinted on me forever.
Yeah.
When as a child, sitting in that Assembly of God church in Fresno, and I heard the word of God, and conviction came to my heart. I realized I was a sinner.
Hallelujah.
I realized I was a sinner. That was my nature. And I needed a Savior. And when they gave the altar call, I went forward, and I knelt down at that pew, and I prayed, and I sincerely asked Jesus to forgive me my sins. And you know, in my case, it doesn't happen in every case. We can't look at people's experiences and start basing that on, you know. But tears came to my eyes. I felt a load of guilt lift off of me.
Yeah.
It's hard to explain. I just felt this burden, this thing lift off of me. And the tears were tears of joy. I mean, at first they were tears of repentance and godly sorrow. You know, there's two kinds of sorrow. The Bible says there's a sorrow of the world and there's the sorrow of God. It's worldly sorrow leads to death. It's depression. Leads to death. And you can lead to suicide to stay in a long time. But godly sorrow, it says, leads to repentance. Because you're sorry about the fact that you have offended God and that you're not in His family and that you need to be. Amen?
Amen.
And so I prayed and I asked the Lord to come in and forgive me my sins, come into my heart, so forth and so on. And He did, and I experienced that. And my life changed. I changed on the inside.
Amen.
Nowadays, some people it seems like, well, just say these words. It doesn't do you any good to say those words.
Yeah.
Over in 1 Corinthians 12, it says, no man can say Jesus is Lord but by the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
By the Holy Ghost.
Now, we can bring anybody off the street that wouldn't know God from a stick in the ground and say Jesus is Lord, and they go, Jesus is Lord. But they can't say it from their heart with conviction unless the Holy Spirit has shown them their need for Jesus and given them what they need in order to say that in faith. See, it's about giving yourself to Him. It's about acknowledging you need Him, so you repent, you give yourself to Him, He gives Himself to you. But now listen, that's not where it stops.
That's right. That's the beginning.
That's just the start. Now you're in the kingdom. You're through the door. You're in the family. You've got the Spirit of God, the nature of God abiding in your spirit. You're born again. Actually, the term in the original is born from above. You already got born down here. Ask your mama, she'll tell you. Amen? You know, we're not like Nicodemus saying, wait a minute, I got to go get my mother's womb again? What are you talking about? No, we're born from above. We're born again. Our spirit, our nature is changed. Paul said, a new creature in Christ that's never existed before. Hallelujah.
Glory.
Praise God. So once that happens, you're in the kingdom, all right. But you're in the kingdom, and guess what? If that's all there was to it, God would have, you wouldn't have taken one more breath. You'd have died and went to heaven right there. You got things to accomplish down here. God has given us authority as human beings on this earth, and he wants us to finish the job he's called us to. So the way we got saved is the way we stay in that place of walking with him. We humble ourselves before him. We bring everything we know, everything we don't know, and everything we think we know, and we lay it at his feet every day.
Amen.
Jesus, you know, the disciples, they kind of got that celebrity mentality going one time in the ministry.
Yeah.
There was thousands of people showing up for healing. The dead were being raised. This was happening. Miracles with food. All this is going on. And, you know, they're kind of like the main attraction there for a while. You know, the spotlight's on them. And so they start getting in the flesh and saying some fleshly things. And, you know, who was it? James and John, was it? That said, we'll call fire down on these people.
Right. Yeah.
We got spiritual power here. We'll call fire down on these people. Right. Jesus looked at them and goes, you don't even know what spirit you're operating under right now. You're operating under a fleshly, demonic deception. That's what they were operating under.
Yeah.
Amen? Yeah. But Jesus, one day, he finally needed to teach them. So he goes over and he grabs this little kid, pulls him up and says, you want to be great in the kingdom? You want to be promoted? You want to be a big shot in the kingdom?
Oh,
be this. Be this. Now, there are times you have to stand up, be a mature Christian, face things. Like God said to Job, stand up and talk to me like a man. But talk to him like a man of God or a woman of God. Not some carnal, dominated, soulish person. Look at your neighbor and say, man, I'm sure glad I'm hearing this today. I'm glad you're hearing it, because you really need it. Amen? But see, we have to remain teachable, trainable. God may want to tell you something you've never known today. Oh, well, I'm just not going to go to church and listen to the Word. I'm not going to get up and talk to God today. What you're saying is you know it all.
Come on.
Oh, I would never say that, Pastor. Well, you're acting like it.
Come on. Yes, yes, yes.
You know, I'm telling you this stuff because I love you. Not because I want to make your life more miserable than it already is. I'm trying to help you out today. Amen. I've been there, done that, got the t-shirt, I understand. Put down the water slide, the whole thing. Amen? Larry Huggins, I remember at one time, of course he lives in the Bay Area now again, but when he was living up there before, his wife would go off, she was a model. And she'd go off on these trips with these other models, you know, fashion models and all this. And they'd come home together on the airplane, and he said, I'd be waiting there at the airport for her and these other guys, husbands and boyfriends or whoever, these other models were there with me. He said, I'd always show up with one rose. And when she got off the plane, I'd give her a rose. He said, I've been doing this a few times. These other guys that didn't have a rose.
Yeah.
One of them said, you know, Huggins, you're getting us in trouble. He said, no, you guys were already in trouble. I'm showing you how to get out of trouble. Amen. Amen. Praise God. That's why I keep listening to other preachers. I get on the internet and listen to other people preach. Because I know John Pursell doesn't know it all. And there's been times where I've really benefited from listening. Now, I always, there again, I always judge everything by the word. If I hear somebody, I don't care if it's my favorite preacher,
right,
say it, and it doesn't line up scripturally, I'm not going to accept it.
Right.
But I'm not going to reject him.
Exactly.
I remember years ago, there was a person that was on the radio consistently, and I'd heard him preach, and I knew about probably at least a third of what I believed they didn't. And so, you know, when you're young and immature, these things, you're like, well, I think you know it all. My group's got it all.
Right.
Yeah, just keep looking straight ahead, and we won't know that you go there.
Right.
And I kind of had that attitude a little bit, you know, and finally I was starting to come out of that a little bit and grow up a little bit. And this guy came on the radio, and I'm, you know, my first reaction before that would have been just to click it off. Because, you know, I don't want to listen to him. Just the brief, well, I can.
Come on.
But I just, I'm going to listen. So I listened, and some of the things he said I didn't agree with, and still don't agree with today. But he made one comment about a scripture I've been wondering about for years.
Right.
And when he said that, revelation flooded me. Like, oh my God, that's what that means.
Yeah.
We got to learn to eat the hay and spit out the sticks.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
Praise God. Yeah. But see, we've got to be willing to let the Lord teach us. We've got to be willing to listen to him tell us today where we're at today and
yes,
what he has for us.
Yes.
You can't live vicariously through me. I can't live through you.
Right.
Even though some things are the same, some things are in general. Like Karen was talking about praying in the Holy Ghost, we all ought to be doing that.
Right.
That's what the Bible says. That's part of that's good doctrine.
Yeah.
We need to pray in the Spirit. We're told over in Ephesians chapter 6 that we're to put on the armor of God and to pray always for all saints in the Spirit.
That's right. Yeah.
He was writing that to a church. He's writing that to the body of Christ. So those things are true. But there are specific things that God wants to teach you to help you out of where you're at.
Yes.
And a lot of it will be just understanding where we're at spiritually right now and stepping into what God has for you, what he's telling you to believe.
Yes. Right.
He dealt with me a couple of years ago. He chastened me. He corrected me. He told me, he said, you've got a faith ceiling on me.
Come on.
You've got a level here that I can't go above in your life. And I said, well, what do you mean? He said, you don't ever go to church and expect to see me grow an arm on somebody that doesn't have an arm.
Yeah. Come on, preach it.
Now, if you would have asked me, do you believe God can do that? Yeah, I believe he can do that. He can do anything. He's God.
Thank you, Lord.
But I wasn't living in expectation of seeing him do that or some other thing that looked impossible.
Yes.
Right.
I would come to church, and in the back of my mind, well, we're going to have church. Well, God heals some headaches, he heals some backs. He sometimes he does this or he does that. We saw him cause a woman to hear about, what, a year ago or so, we saw him cause a woman to hear who didn't have a nerve in her ear anymore. That's totally miraculous. We saw him heal that little boy that had that deformed double knee situation. Those are great works, mighty works. But I had to admit to God. See, you might as well be honest with him. You might as well be honest with him. Now listen, here's why. Because he says, I desire truth in the inner parts. It can't work when you're playing these little gospel games and this little pretend stuff. And
you're right, man.
Come on, preach that.
And he said, from now on, here's where I want you to believe. Here's your faith.
Come on.
And he gave me Ephesians chapter 3, verse what is it, 19 and 20. It says, he's able to do exceeding abundantly beyond what we ask or think. You hear me say that a lot? Because I remind myself, that's what I believe today.
Yeah.
I believe God can do something in this room today that I have never seen him do, and it's even beyond what I can ask or think. As a matter of fact, he showed me I'm always doing that.
Yes.
You may not always see the results of it right now, but if you'll put your faith right there, I'll start doing things that you don't understand.
Amen.
See, there's some things he'll do, and the way he does them, if he tried to explain it to us, we wouldn't get it anyway.
Exactly.
Right. Jesus told his disciples, I've got a lot more to say to you about this, but you won't be able to comprehend it.
Exactly.
Paul said that to the Corinthian church. He said, because you have refused to grow up and be mature, and become a disciple, you're a bunch of spiritual babies fighting each other in the flesh, and he says, I can't share things with you that I'd like to share with you. I'm having to give you milk all the time because you're not ready for the meat. You'll choke on it.
Come on. Amen.
Bring it on. I'm 65 years old, been in the ministry for 30 years. I can't get in this mindset, well, bless God, I understand what the ministry is about. I'm tired of this anyway, I think I'll just retire. I'm glad Moses didn't feel it. Well, he probably did feel that way, but God had a little burning bush for him. See, one of the worst things you can do in your life is start making your own decisions for yourself and leave God out of the picture.
I'm a Christian.
I didn't say you weren't. Have any of your kids ever made their own decisions in spite of what their father and mother was telling them and went out and did something that they thought they ought to do without your advice in the situation and never regretted it?
Yeah.
Or have you ever done that when you were?
Yeah.
Sure.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
We're all guilty. What are we going to learn? We got to hear Father's voice.
Yeah.
Jesus, the Bible says he had the anointing without measure.
Yeah.
All of the Holy Ghost gifts and abilities and whatever God could give him and could come from heaven was in him and on him.
Yeah.
But yet he said, I do nothing unless I see my Father do it.
Yes.
He didn't say, Father, thanks, I got it from here. I'll take it from here. I don't know how to straighten this real well. Thank you, Dad. Take a vacation for a while. He understood he needed to hear his Father's voice.
Yes.
He needed to have that input from heaven.
How can we have seen?
That's true.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. How many of you are glad you heard this today?
Amen.
I didn't look up to see who raised their hand. See, God's trying to take us in.
Yes.
See, can I say this?
Yes.
Good, because I'm going to anyway. You can't fix your problem.
Amen.
You can't deliver yourself.
Amen.
That's right.
You can't change.
Amen.
You can't do it. So what you do is you become a living sacrifice. You get before God, you say, here I am, Jesus. I'm coming to you like a little child. Teach me. Lead me. Talk to me. Take me by the hand. When we keep that kind of heart before God, then that's when he can move us into maturity. He can move us into greater things. He can use us for things that we never thought he could use us for. And listen, it's a daily thing.
Yes, it is.
It's not a Sunday thing.
Right.
God uses this time to confirm things to people, minister to people. There's a corporate anointing that has, there are different reasons for all of this here, and it's wonderful, and I love it.
Yeah.
I don't go to church because I have to. I go to church because I get to.
Amen.
If I wasn't the pastor, I'd be here.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
But that day-to-day walk with God, it's so important for you and your family.
Yes, it is.
Turn over to Psalm. I'm going to wind it up here. Psalm 112. Thank you, Lord. Now, I'm not talking about some kind of religious ritual and bondage. Oh, my God, I didn't spend my 4 hours with God today. The devil's going to get me. Or I hear people saying stuff like this. Well, I speak these scriptures every day over my life. And then if they don't speak it one day, they freak out.
Right.
Now, if God told you, if you were in your relationship with God, God says, I want you to begin to declare this over your life, or over your family, or over your city, or whatever, then do that. And you do it until he tells you to stop. Now you're doing it out of relationship.
Amen.
Amen. But some people are superstitious.
Right.
Oh, my God, I forgot to cover everybody with the blood this morning. If you think just doing things, the Bible says you'll not be heard for your much speaking. Those words have to come from some. They have to be spiritual words. Amen? And some of us are definitely not heard for our much speaking because the things we're speaking aren't scriptural.
Yeah.
They pray for God, change my husband, change my wife, change my boss, change my pastor. they go around and curse them with their words. Complain, gripe, moan, groan. And God says, I can't answer that mess. You can't bless and curse out of the same mouth. Read the book of James. It says it's like putting a fountain, putting clean, clear, drinkable, wonderful water in, and then putting salt water in too. The clear water is not going to neutralize the salt water. The salt water is going to ruin the clean water.
Right?
There was a book written back in the late 70s called Hung by the Tongue. Anybody ever read that book? Besides me, old guys? Like, still get it. Hung by the Tongue. It had a picture of some guy, you know, a tongue around his neck like a noose. Hallelujah. Did you find Psalm 112?
Yes.
Now, back in a certain time in my life, not too many years back, the Lord, in my daily walk with Him, listening, just get up, I need to hear your voice. What do you have to say to me? See, I don't get up and say, oh, I'm going to read my promise box today, and I'm going to read my three chapters that it says to read in this Bible I have.
Right.
Now, those things are okay if you want to do them. There's nothing wrong with it. But if you think that's a relationship with God, you're wrong.
Yeah.
I like to read a website called The Elijah List. I usually read it every day. There's a couple of posts on there. It comes from different prophetic people around the earth, and there's a lot of confirmation, encouragement, good teaching, and edification in it. So I read it. But I don't take that as my relationship with God.
Amen.
Some people will see some minister, you know, having what seems to be success in the church, and here's what he teaches and the way he does things, and then they'll say, well, why don't you do that at this church? Because God didn't tell me to do that at this church.
Yeah.
I've had people over the years, how come you don't write a book? God's never told me to write a book. Yeah, but you have that revelation. But I don't just go do something because I want to do it.
Yeah.
I know ministers that have got garages stacked full of boxes of books they wrote, and they owe $30,000 to the printer or whatever. And I'm not saying God didn't tell them to write the book. I don't know, that's between them and God, but maybe He didn't.
Yeah.
Maybe He just got excited about a revelation.
That's right.
Just like I was excited about this revelation right here. But I got up here and I prayed that prayer again.
Right.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
See, I'm not called to straighten out the flock. I'm called to feed the flock.
Yes. Yes.
And sometimes it's medicine.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Psalm 112. A few years back, in my relationship, I get up in the morning and I say, Lord, what do you want me to read today? Lord, what do you have to say to me today? I don't get up and say, God, here's my day, and here's what's happening in my life, and I want you to do this, I want you to do that, I want you to do this, I want you to do that, and I bless this, and I bless that, and da 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 da. See you later, God. And God's going, I couldn't get a word in edgewise. I just worship Him. Sometimes I'll have a number drop into my mind. Psalm 51. So I just flip over there and start reading Psalm 51. And it usually is something He's revealing to me, saying to me, reminding me of.
Yes.
That maybe I let go of or forgotten.
Right.
Or maybe the devil's attacking me or my family in a certain way. And then that psalm is God's perspective, and it edifies my faith and causes me to be able to decree that. Amen.
Amen.
Now, out of that relationship is where your strength's going to come and things are going to work out.
That's right.
See, the devil wants you, he wants you to believe that look around at the church and whatever the average Christian is, that's okay. Average is an enemy to the best. Average is an enemy to what's the best? The best is you hearing from God, living out of the Word of God and the Spirit of God that's working in you, and being willing to step out of the boat if that's what it takes.
Yeah.
Being willing to be a Gideon. I've got Gideon in there somewhere. Being willing, instead of being afraid and hiding in a corner, to step up and do something bold that's going to deliver the whole nation. But that came out of an angel talking to him. That came out of a conversation that he had from heaven. Well, a few years back, the Lord gave me this psalm, Psalm 112. I read it. It blessed me. Just the basic info in it is good. Let me just read it. Praise you, the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord and delighteth greatly in his commandment. Now notice the blessings on somebody that fears or that is submitted to understands that you have to respect God for who he is and live by his truth. You can't be frivolous?
Frivolous.
With that. Amen?
Amen.
That delighteth greatly in his commandments.
Yeah.
See, the word will never be a fulfilled promise to you unless it becomes a commandment to you first.
Amen.
Yeah.
All of it. Amen.
God.
Amen? When you receive that as I obey that, I'm a servant to you in that, I live by that. I receive that as a command to my life. Mm-hmm. Then it becomes a fulfilled promise eventually and it becomes a blessing and freedom in your life.
Amen.
The people want to live in promises without living under command.
Come on, where's the army?
Jesus said, if you're my disciple, he says, you're going to do what I say.
Right.
Remember, they had a group of people following around, and they kept calling him, rabbi. They kept calling him master and Lord. And he says, why are you calling me Lord? You don't do what I say.
Come on, preach that.
I'm not your Lord.
Amen.
You're not submitted to me. You're not listening to me. You're not hanging on every word I say and seeking to obey that.
Come on.
You're over here doing the Christian buffet thing.
Come on.
Oh, I like this. Oh, what? He said that? No, I don't want that.
Come on.
Don't preach me no message on judgment, Pastor. You preach me on the promise.
Right.
You
can't have the promise unless you judge
yourself. Joyce Meyer had a book on Christian discipline and some of these things we don't like to hear about sometimes. And she said that nobody would buy it at a book table. So she retitled it, repackaged it, and put something on it like, How to Live a Fully Blessed Life.
Yeah.
People ate it up like hotcakes.
Come on. Thank you, God.
Praise you, the Lord blesses a man that fears the Lord and delights greatly in his commandments. His seed, that word seed, means his offspring or his family circle.
Amen.
You have authority where your family is concerned.
Absolutely.
Shall be mighty. This word mighty, you look it up in the original, means mighty warriors.
Ah, I love that.
Mighty spiritual warriors. Not spiritual wimps.
Come on.
Mighty warriors.
Mighty spiritual warriors. They will stand up to the devil.
Warrior.
It's like when Isaac was on the altar and God stopped Abraham from sticking him with the knife. And then he began to prophesy. One of the things he said about Isaac is he will confront the enemy in the gate. He's going to be an overcomer. He's going to be a victorious one. Every one of your family, you need to pray that and decree that over them. His seed shall be mighty on the earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. Wealth and, now here's what you can like. Verse 3. Wealth and riches shall be in his house. I don't believe in the prosperity gospel. That's funny. I guess God must have hiccuped right here.
Yeah.
Stuttered. I hear some preachers on TV sometimes, that prosperity message. You know, and then I listen to what they think it is. It's not the prosperity message. It's what they interpreted the prosperity message to be.
Right.
And they're always the same ones that are going, you better help us or we're not going to be on anymore.
Come on, Pastor.
Moving right along.
Yeah.
Wealth and riches shall be in his house, and his righteousness endureth forever. His right standing before God. Unto the upright. See, that's that person I'm talking about this morning. That's walking with God, listening to him, submitted to him, staying in a humble position, letting God tell you what to do, not you trying to live your own life without it.
Amen.
It says, unto the upright there ariseth light and darkness. He didn't say there wouldn't be darkness. He said when the darkness shows up, the light's going to show up too. Revelation's coming. I'm going to enlighten the eyes of the enemies attacking your kids or your grandkids. I'm going to come in and I'm going to shine a light so bright it's going to run the devil's darkness out.
Amen.
Amen.
Word of the Lord.
A good man shows favor and lends. He guides his affairs with discretion. That's another thing right there. You've got to have a giving heart. You can't be a tightwad for God. You have to have a heart. See? Live your life to be a blessing.
Amen. Right?
I mean, he already told you he's going to take care of the wealth and riches part for you.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm not saying be frivolous and just throw stuff around and all this, but what I'm saying is have a motive. God, how can I bless you today and bless people today?
Yeah.
Lord, if you want me to give some money to somebody today, have them come across my path. I may only have $2, but I'll give them that dollar by faith. And I'll tell you exactly what's going to happen. You get ready to get a whole bunch of dollars.
Yeah. Okay.
Whatever you live to be is what you're going to get back.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Surely he shall not be moved forever. You're like that house built on the rock. When the wind and rains come, the righteous shall be an everlasting remembrance. Now what does that mean? That, you know, 200 years from now, if the earth is still here, they're going to remember the name of John Pursell? No, it means that there's a perpetual memorial before the face of God about you. Come on.
Yes. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
What did God tell Cornelius when that angel showed up? You got it.
That's good.
Come on. Well, you and I are clicking today, aren't we?
No.
Hallelujah. What did that angel tell Cornelius? He said, a memorial is before God on the throne about you, your prayers, and your giving. See, he was living to be a blessing. He was praying for his family, praying for his city. He was, you know, he was looking for opportunities to give, to be a blessing. He would listen to God, not look at his bank account.
Amen. It's good.
Amen. You're an everlasting remembrance. I remember Kenneth Copeland one day, many, many, many years ago, I heard him say this. His mom was a prayer warrior. I mean, his mom was a prayer warrior. He said when he was still in the world and out, you know, in motorcycle gangs and raising hell and demonized and all messed up, he said that he came home one day and he was walking up the sidewalk to his house and these two Baptist preachers are coming out of the house that had been to this prayer meeting his mom was holding. And he said, he heard one of the Baptist preachers say, you know, that's the first time I've ever felt sorry for the devil. Talking about his mother. Now she would get with the program. But after he was in ministry, he said, the Lord spoke to him one day and said, I'm not going to let you fail. And he said, Lord, why? I mean, I know better men than me, smarter men than me that have failed and, you know, ended up on the spiritual junkie. He said, I'm not going to let you fail because your mother is in my face every day. Some of you sitting here right now, you're sitting here right now because your mama was in his face. Or your dad or somebody else that maybe didn't even totally know you. Hallelujah. Everlasting remembrance. Look at this. You'll like this part. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. Bad news. His heart, his spirit is fixed, trusting in the Lord. See, if you have a relationship with God, you're going to know to a certain degree what's coming down the pipe. And God will show you some negative things maybe that are going to happen. But more than that, he's going to show you how, what he's doing and what he's bringing things into. And so when the devil shows up to try to lie to you about that or try to cause something in the natural to make it look like it's not true,
right,
you just stand there solid and say, devil, I already know how this is coming out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Lord.
Right.
Lord.
Lord. Hallelujah.
Word.
He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. His heart is established. And he shall not be afraid until he sees his desire upon his enemies. Glory to God. We're talking about spiritual enemies. Amen. Of course, if people are going to buddy up with the devil, they may get themselves caught up in it. He has dispersed. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endureth forever. His horn, the word horn there, means your authority or your power. The God-given authority and power that God has given you as a human being on this earth, to dominate this earth, as he told Adam and Eve. His horn shall be exalted with honor. The wicked shall see it and be grieved. He'll grind his teeth in hatred. That's what the devil's doing right now over your life. He's having a hissy fit. He's grinding his teeth in anger. He shall gnash with his teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked shall perish.
Jesus.
The Lord gave me this psalm. He kept giving it to me. I don't know how he works with you, but with me, he'll show me something, and then maybe I'll study other things, or this will happen, or that. And then a week or so later, he brings me back to it. And so I'll meditate on it, and I'll, Lord, show me, give me revelation, what are you saying here? And then maybe I don't get a whole lot out of it, or I do, or whatever, and I move on. And then a week later, here comes again. And so finally, in my lightning fast mind, I figure out God's dealing with it. And I know, after doing this for years, I know, okay, this pattern means he's giving me this for a reason.
Yes.
And there were some circumstances that took place not long after this that made it look in the natural realm like the exact opposite of what these words said was going to happen and be that way forever.
Yes.
And I'm not going to tell you I was, this word. Smiley face. It hit me hard. It was hard emotionally on me. It was hard on my soul. But after the initial shock, I went, wait a minute.
That's right.
God's already prepared me.
Amen.
He's given me Psalm 112. Why? Two reasons. So I could focus on him and decree and not start agreeing with the devil. Not align myself spiritually with the devil through criticism, through fear, through gossip, through whatever.
Yeah.
But I can get over here and say, I don't care what you're doing, devil. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care how much water's under the bridge or whatever. My God has already said, here's what happens to a righteous man. And I'm a righteous man in the righteousness of Christ, in Jesus Christ. And I qualify under this Psalm 112. So this is what's going to happen to my family, my children, my grandchildren, and as far as I'm concerned, my spiritual family.
Yes.
See, I didn't just take this for my bloodline, natural bloodline. I took it for you. You and I are blood relatives through the blood of Jesus. Come on.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, and the Lord told me this one time. He said, I do this so that you won't miss a beat.
Amen.
You'll know how it's going to come out.
Yes.
Didn't Jesus say, I'll show you things to come?
Yes.
The Bible says he shows us the end from the beginning. Yes. He shows us how it's going to come out. He showed Joseph, you're going to be a man of honor. A man of authority.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Paul wrote to Timothy and said, take those prophetic words that you've gotten and use them as a weapon against the enemy and the circumstances that are around you right now.
Yes.
I know how it's coming out.
Amen.
It's amazing how the oppression and the circumstances doesn't affect you as much as it normally would, because you already know how it's going
to
come out.
Exactly. Yeah. That's how it's supposed to be.
Amen.
Yeah.
And then secondly, he told me this one day. He said, I don't want you to waste 1 minute of your life being tormented by the devil.
Come on.
Exactly. I don't want you to waste 1 minute of your life in wonder.
Yeah.
Or in torment.
Yeah.
Or in fear.
Yeah.
Now, does the spirit of fear come? Yes, he comes to all of us daily. But he told me, he says, if you already know what I've said about this and about your family or whatever it is, when that comes, you just pull out the sword of the spirit and...
Amen.
Yes,
Lord. Amen.
You run him off with it.
Yep.
You decree it. Matter of fact, if you read it enough and read it to yourself out loud and praise God for it, you'll get out of whatever you're in into the joy of the Lord, and people will think you're nuts because you're in bad circumstances, but you're acting like you're not.
Amen.
Don't live your life by the circumstances around you. It's like the Lord told me, I'm going to close my Bible, so I'll quit.
That don't mean nothing to me.
That don't mean nothing to me. Give away my secrets. I forgot what I was going to say. Maybe I'm supposed to quit.
Amen.
Lord, let's all stretch your hand toward Mike. Lord, forgive Mike.
I'll take a special prayer.
Praise God. The point being this is he doesn't want us to live outside of his peace. And if you find yourself outside of peace, there's a reason. And you need to find out what that reason is.
Right.
Well, I know what I'll do. I'll call Pastor and he'll pray over me. If God tells you to do that, do it. I've had him tell me to have people pray with me. But go to him. Lord, why am I not peace? And be willing to spend some time with him. Keep asking him that question. Stand before him. It may take 2 or 3 days for certain things to develop and for him to show. But he'll show you.
Yes, he will.
And he'll help you get back into peace.
Yes, he will.
We have a glorious future. Now, all kinds of crazy things are going to happen in this earth.
That's right.
I'm going to tell you right now.
Right.
We've just really come into a place where there's going to be a spiritual clash in this earth like we've never seen before. Now, you say that to some people here. What's going to happen to my bank account? But God comes and picks a fight on purpose sometimes at his time to set his people free.
Glory to God!
And that was what I was going to preach earlier. The other thing. God take the fight to set his people free.
Yes.
Praise God. Will this help you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Go ahead. It does, yeah. I thought about that.
I had a, this goes right along with, I didn't know when the Lord was wanting me to share it, but he's witnessed me to share it. But I had a dream. Let's see, it would have been earlier Wednesday morning. In this dream, I was at my house. Dream started out, I was at my house, and I was sitting in my living room there, and all of a sudden I heard a real big explosion, like a traumatic type thing, like not just a firework, but I mean like an explosion that shook my home. And at first I jumped into the ground, kind of just because it freaked, scared me, and I kind of covered up. Then after it settled, I got up and I went over to my front window, and I looked out my front window, and I kind of looked over to the east of my street, neighborhood I'm in. And just a whole area over there had exploded, and just mayhem. There was just debris, like you'd see something. And the house next door to me was damaged. Fatally, I guess, if you want to call it that way, it was damaged bad. And the scene changed, and immediately the city of Madera came in onto my street, and they came in and they tore that house out, and they looked at my house, and I went out and looked at my house, and there was nothing wrong with my home. My home was in peace, my home looked normal, all that. The city of Madera came in, they tore down that house, they tore up the road, they tore up the curbs, and they put, and this is all happening in seconds, it's not like days, like we think in our mind it would take a process to do all this, but this is all happening in seconds in this dream. They came in and put a brand new road on my street, brand new curbs on my street, and they made that whole area there kind of ready again to be built on again. And let me tell you what the Lord showed me. There's some different scenes I'm going to get to in just a second, but the Lord showed me in that it's like Dad just said right now, some things are going to happen in this earth that are not going to be fun, easy to look at, easy to understand, or anything like that. But the ones that are following God will be protected and will not be touched.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Not only did God protect me, my family, but he also gave us prosperity, gave us a newness, a new beginning, a new path, that road. Chaos is going around us, but God's using that chaos to shift his people into a newness. And then the dream went on. The next scene of this dream, I'm sitting in church. We're sitting here in a meeting with you guys. And I'm sitting in the congregation, and I'm looking up, and I saw Kim Clement standing over here. Some of y'all know where I'm headed with that. I saw Kim Clement standing over here. And he was standing here, and he had his hands folded, and all he was doing was this.
Yeah.
Sounds like him.
And Rodney Howard Brown was standing behind the pulpit, and he was ministering the word. Very strong, tangible anointing.
Yeah.
Very strong joy. People were getting delivered, healed. Just the tangible power of God was in the building. And I was sitting in the audience, I was looking at Rodney Howard Brown, and I looked over Kim Clement. I'm like, is he going to say something? Is he going to, because he's a prophet. Right. Is he going to say something? I kept thinking in my dream, is Kim going to say something? Is he going to say something? Is he going to say something? And he never said anything. He just stood there. And the scene shifted and went on into some other personal things I'm not going to get into. But I woke up that morning, Wednesday morning, and I went into the living room and I got on the internet and I was looking at some stuff on there. And I found out that Kim Clement had died the night before.
Yeah.
Had passed.
Yeah.
And it just, I mean, I was like, what? And I immediately called Dad because I'm like, I've never had a dream with Kim Clement in a dream before. And I knew it wasn't just a coincidence. It was a God dream.
Yeah.
And what God began to show me out of that was, number one, this is kind of obvious, but, you know, when people leave this earth, their prophetic words, their voice, their prayers, they stay.
Right.
They move on into the cloud of witnesses, but their words are here. Their prophetic voice is still here on the earth.
Yes.
And so God was showing me that we're in a season where there's chaos around us. It's Isaiah 60 really is what it is. You just read that chapter and you'll get this dream. But there's chaos going all on around us.
Right.
But your family,
amen.
Your descendants,
yes.
What Dad just read there, out of those verses there, your spiritual children, your family, your blood,
yes.
Amen, you're the body of Christ, your brothers and sisters, that no matter what's going on, you look to heaven. You'll look to heaven. You'll God will protect. He'll keep. He'll shift you into the new beginnings. And he'll continue to shift you into new things. And those words that have been said are here on earth about you still. Those prayers from your grandma and grandpa, your prayers from your great-grandma and grandpa, your prayers from your parents, your uncles, aunts, your best friend, whatever, whoever God used over the years in your life. Those prophetic words and decrees and declarations over you will stand in your life if you'll believe them.
Yes.
And that's what Cam Clement represented, that prophet's anointing, that prophet's mantle. And then Rodney Howard Brown, his part in that dream was that we are going to be able to be used by the power of God in a tangible anointing to set captives free during the chaos in this world. Some will believe it, some won't. But I'm going to tell you right now, we have never, and I've never experienced the power that we're going to be sensing in these end days to help people get out of all kinds of garbage. God's going to use us powerfully to pull people out of the pit of hell and out of the trap. That's why the enemy's attacking you.
Come on.
The way he's attacking you. That means something to me and to a lot of people in here.
Yes.
He's a stinking liar.
Amen.
He loses.
Yes.
Right.
Every time.
He loses. We're the faithful ones. You're a faithful one. You're a child of God. If you're born again, you're a child of God. He loves you. He knows your name. He knows every hair on your head. And he has a future and a hope and a love and a blessing.
Yes.
Some of you feel like you're getting jumped by the enemy. Because I feel like that too. It's a fight every day for me. It has been for a while. I'm telling you though. When we feel weak on the inside, he is strong. And we keep looking. And we keep looking and we keep getting before the face of the Lord. And he's going to start telling you and start talking to you about strategies. And the reason why the enemy is attacking so hard. Number one, you're coming. God's taking you because you've been sincere before the Lord. And your heart is for God. And of course, the enemy doesn't like that. So he comes after harder and faster. But God's taking you out of stuff. And he's speaking to you and he's showing you. And he's giving you wisdom and knowledge and revelation. How to get out of that forever. This thing that's bugging you is not going to last forever.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now. This attack that's happening to me is not going to last forever. It's on its last leg.
Amen.
And I recognize the enemy and I know what he's trying to do. And it's a fact what he's trying to do, but he does not win. He does not if you will not allow him. You let God talk. You let God show you. You let God, and when He shows you, when He talks to you, you implement what He's saying to you in your life, and you let Him help you with that area. He says very specific things to us about how to deal with certain situations. And that's what I'm learning. I'm learning to listen to that now. And I'm learning to implement that and walk by faith. And even when I don't feel like it, I do it anyways. I say it anyways. I believe it anyways. Praise God. Amen. So, doesn't matter what He's doing. He's got us. He protects us.
You know that, hang on just a minute, Pat. That element of that dream where it was in our church, Kim Clement standing over here, Rodney Howard Brown is preaching. Rodney Howard Brown, like he said, symbolizes the tangible deliverance. And God's really been talking to me the last year about how much deliverance is going to take place in this move He's starting. That people are going to get set free. Even people that think they're free are going to get set free. But Kim Clement, I don't know how many of you know this. Kim Clement, I don't think he's ever been to Jared, but I know him. But he was in Fresno a number of years ago, and somebody came forward for prayer. He asked them where they're from. I wasn't in the meeting, but I heard about it later. They said, I'm from Madera. He said, oh, Madera, where's Madera? And they told him, and he went on to minister. And then I don't remember the details, but more than once he kept coming back to Madera. He said, there's something's happening in Madera. God, there's going to be a revival in Madera.
Yeah.
He started prophesying about Madera. He began to release a word about revival and the word of the Lord over Madera. And I believe that is, maybe there's more to it than that, but that was what the Lord was showing in that dream, is that what He released prophetically over this city and this area, that even though He's in the great cloud of witnesses, and you know what the great cloud of witnesses are doing? They're witnessing. They're up there speaking before the throne. They don't know all of the details. They don't know what ham sandwich you had for lunch. But they know about your spiritual destiny. Your grandmother's up there right now. She knows about your spiritual destiny. And she's witnessing to that. She's read the book of resumes about you. And they're witnessing before the Lord on your behalf. Amen? But there's that powerful anointing that Rodney Howard Brown operates in. Many people don't understand him because they don't understand joy. You know how God reacts to the devil? He laughs at it. Yeah. It says, he who sits in the heavens shall laugh. When he sees the enemy plotting and planning against his people, he laughs. And you know what it says? It says, because he sees his days coming. We need to learn to laugh at the devil. Don't get in and play the anger game with him. If he's angry and having a nervous breakdown over something, don't get in there and have it with him. Just start laughing at him. Kenneth Hagin used to call people out of the audience by the Spirit and say, come up here and lead us in laughter. People got to come up there and the anointing God come on and start laughing. It was spread out across the congregation and everybody's laughing. Except the stick in the mud religious types. They'll let God blow them up with dynamite. Hallelujah! Well, listen to him. I'm telling you, the line's drawn in the sand.
Amen.
And the Lord told me, guys, when He gave me that Isaiah 61 and 2, you've heard me talk about that before. He said, when you see the earth, the world go into chaos and darkness and go down, you're going to see the church go up.
Yes.
The glorious life.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
And we're coming into those days.
Yes.
When Billy Graham leaves this earth, look out.
Amen.
Because he is the Elijah of soul winning.
Yes.
I read this morning on the Elijah list, his son had a post on there. And this last year, I think they won something like a million and a half people in America to Christ, just in the things that he did in America. He has a worldwide mantle of soul winning, and we're getting ready to see souls come into the kingdom of God. And when he leaves, you watch. When Oral Roberts left, the word of the Lord was that the healing and miracles will expand. And they did. We've had more in our church than we had ever had before. Because we believe that.
Yeah.
It's a hold of it. Oh, praise God. Stand up so I'll shut up. Amen. Does this help you today?
Yes.
He's calling you to the secret place with Him.
Yes.
He's calling you to come and sit at His feet and listen to Him. He's calling you to come. He doesn't want you to be not ready for what's ahead. He doesn't want you to get swept up in a river of fear as people are going to be swept up in. He wants you to be able to listen to him and move with him. When you do, it's not going to be just a drop in the bucket. God's going to use you. The rivers of living water that are in you are going to flow. And the foe cannot stand against the flow. Oh, glory. Come on, let's just rejoice. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you. We rejoice in you this morning, Lord. We praise you for who you are. We praise you for what you're doing. Glory, 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 glory. Praise God. Lord, if we haven't been allowing you to talk to us, spending some time with you, we repent right now in the name of Jesus. And we make a decision that we're going to, if we do anything in a day, part of it is going to be that we just sit at your feet, fellowship with you, and listen to you, what you have to say to us. And we'll do whatever you tell us to do. We'll go wherever you tell us to go. We'll be whatever you tell us to be. And we'll not try to be something you're not telling us to be. We give you praise.